Now it's time to talk about TNA Impact for January 7th, 2006.
Now it's time. True.
This is TNA, the new face of professional wrestling.
More boys are coming.
There's fucking aliens and satellites and AJ Styles. There's a lot going on here.
Dude,
this intro is crazy, dude. There's so much going on.
This is a very 2006 intro. I don't know the band that is playing this recap video, but it sounded very much like 3 Days Grace.
The show started with a music video.
Yeah.
Just a straight up music video. They didn't give you any context. All they showed
was just stuff happening.
Music video and Christian Cage going, there's someone here, and it just shows a big scorpion. Who could this be? Who is this man?
They do that later too. I mean, I'll just jump ahead real quick. They show like the graphics for Final Resolution, and it's Sting and Christian against Jarrett and Monty Brown, and everyone has a picture except Sting, whose picture is just a big white scorpion.
That could have been anybody. Yeah, who is this guy?
Like, what the fuck?
I guess they were trying to say like, you guys don't know what Sting looks like. He could look like shit.
Well, yeah, we find out later in the show.
Well,
yeah,
you know,
we do.
You got Jared'd. That's what that's called. Get Jared'd. Yeah,
the TNA intro video that they play for this, I always remember Daniels turning around because I always thought it was so weird. Like, what is he just like turning? Do you guys remember?
They got a lot going on here. I remember the thing I remember mostly from was AJ Styles doing the Phenomenal Forearm at the screen, and then Jarrett hitting a jabroni with a
That's almost like Rikishi doing a butt to the camera.
Damn, I would love if someone edited the Rikishi ass into that TNA intro.
Rikishi's ass.
Put your prayer. It's just Rikishi's
ass. He was in TNA for a minute.
That's true. I think he
didn't do very
there,
much.
Though.
They threw him straight into a reverse battle royale, so yeah, he probably fucking hated it.
Oh my god, he was Junior Fatu.
Yeah, they're like, look at this guy, we can't say his name, but you know who he is, look at his ass. Yeah, I do know this guy.
he lost in his first match to Christian, due to distraction by AJ Styles, and then he teamed with Samoa Joe and LAX, and then they lost. I don't know if he ever won on this company.
Just do the stink face, dude. Is that
simple?
He
was released from TNA due to he and TNA management failing to reach an agreement about a pay raise, and then Chris Harris took Fatu's spot in the Fight for the Right semifinal match.
The pay raise? He was there for 3 matches. He said, all right, that's enough of that. I'm going
to bump that up, Ooze.
I ain't going to play a fucking other down.
I'll do that for another 50 grand.
He walked into Jeff Jarrett's office raising the roof. Raise my pay.
He backed that ass up in Jarrett's office. No, he did the moonwalk backwards in like Scotty.
Oh
Kennedy.
Shit! He put
he's
the chains on
arm
too.
Thing,
or Brian
yeah.
Christopher.
Yeah,
yeah
the
he
arm
did
thing.
It.
The he's got to do the arm thing. He puts the glasses on. The lights in the office go off, and he's just standing there.
He's doing this whole. Jeff Jarrett's drunk behind his desk.
No, Jeff Jarrett doesn't drink. Jarrett
that's
drink.
True. That's true.
He doesn't drink, bro.
It's a real. all right, so like we said, it starts off with a music video, and well, 4Live Crew has been going through some issues. You know, Kip James came through, ruined the whole fucking dynamic. This is all screwed up.
Sucks.
Bullet Bob Armstrong, which is BG James' dad, he's still around at this point, and he's like, man, you guys got to get back. You know, your boys, you guys are cool. Like I used to. It's like when your parents.
It was
like,
a mark for them.
He's like, yeah. He's like, your parents are like, what happened to that friend? He's like, come here. Like, we just don't hang out like that no more. He's like, oh, I really like them. I really like those guys.
Like
you should get
kid.
Back together with them. Yeah. How about you not worry about what I'm doing?
Yeah, go away.
So Bullet Bob Armstrong's like, you guys should get together. And he goes, I'm going to go talk to Conan. And Conan said, yo, what's up, Bullet Bob? You know, I always liked you. And he dragged him in the parking lot and beat the shit out of him.
Come here, old man. Let's talk for a minute. He whoops his ass.
Oh, that ruled. Yeah, they dragged him into the parking lot, beat the living shit out of him.
And that was the beginning of the music video, and then it goes into just the actual music video.
Yeah, so Bullet Bob Armstrong gets beat up, and then he goes, and Sting's coming! No
more
context.
Stings are coming.
If we didn't already know about 4Live Crew and all, you know, Kip James coming through and all that, if we didn't already know the context, this music video would not have told us what this con. They didn't even say the name 4Live Crew.
Honestly, I know about it, and I'm still confused.
Yeah, I was very confused.
They didn't even say they didn't even say the name or anything. They're just like, yeah, Bullet Bob. Yeah. This old guy. We don't even know who Bullet Bob. If you don't know who Bullet Bob Armstrong is,
that's even worse.
It's just an old guy.
Bullet Bob
I don't
trying to help them out, and then why did he get his ass whooped? And why did they care?
So, anyways, play the fucking rock music. Here we go, baby. Sting's coming. So yeah, Christian Cage announces that someone is a part of the TNA roster. He doesn't say their name, and it's a Scorpion. So you assume it's Sting. Could have been anybody though.
Nah, it's The Rock as a Scorpion King. He's coming.
Wow, that would have been crazy.
They should have put a crown on the Scorpion. That would have been great. Scorpion King.
It should have been a Brahma bull with a scorpion on the back.
Should have just said Dwayne The Rock Johnson is coming.
No, bro, they couldn't even give Rikishi a raise. They're not bringing in The Rock.
They didn't give Rikishi a raise because they're trying to bring in The Rock and Chris Jericho. They can't give Rikishi.
Sorry.
This is TNA.
He ain't dead. He ain't The Rock.
Don't want to hear your big mouth talking about me.
I ain't going to give you a fucking pay raise, Rikishi.
That's how all the TNA contract negotiations go.
I can't believe that song is there. You're not The Rock, so you're not going to pay raise.
I can't believe you had to change that song, like that lyric, because they could have The Rock.
They really changed it. He ain't dead. He ain't.
It says he ain't dead. He ain't Jarrett. Doesn't make any sense.
No, you go, he ain't
what
dead.
Do you mean,
he
ain't not
what?
Jarrett.
No,
yes, you are Jarrett. You drunk fuck.
He ain't dead. He ain't.
Dude, I can't get over that. You were getting you walked to the office. You ain't The Rock.
You ain't getting this fat check, boy, in my world.
You ain't dead. You ain't The Rock. You ain't getting paid shit, Rikishi.
That's Jarrett's negotiating
style. And then he does
style.
The strut.
Are
he
you
does
dead
the Jarrett strut.
Or are you The Rock? If answer either of these is no, get the fuck out of here, Slapma.
It's like one of those flowchart things where you go down the line. Are you dead? Yes. Okay, over here. Get a pay raise. Are you The Rock? Yes. Get a pay raise. Are you not? Damn.
Sorry, Ooze.
Yeah, I imagine Jarrett ending it with sorry, Ooze.
Oh, my God.
Hits him on a guitar.
He does the strut. Let's go.
Broke a million guitars, never give Rikishi a dime.
Mike Graham's in the back. Oh, hell no.
So Rikishi's not on this show.
Rikishi.
This show has nothing to do with Rikishi at all. He wasn't around at TNA.
So Rikishi's not here.
Rikishi doesn't have come around to 2007. It's a year after this. I don't even know if Jarrett was there when Rikishi was there.
This show has nothing to do with Rikishi at all.
God damn it.
Oh, holy shit, I'm sweating, man. What the fuck?
My stomach hurts already.
All right. Let me try to figure out here. All right, so
he ain't dead. He ain't The Rock. You ain't getting a fucking pay raise.
Get the fuck out of my office.
Free woo.
Oh
my god.
Fuck.
But yes, there was a video package to start the show.
What was the band?
Four
Who
Life
was the band?
Crew.
Do you know?
3 days. Four Life Crew did the song.
Yeah. 4 days grace.
Four days grace.
And they did get a pay raise.
Yeah. Well, they're not dead, and they're not The Rock.
Do you think TNA? You think TNA paid for the rights to use any of the music they ever used on the show? Do you think they
Hell
just
yeah,
like
bro,
slid
Dale
by?
Oliver was on the payroll.
Yeah, you're right. He was in that band.
I don't think Dale Oliver did this song, though.
No, absolutely not. This is not a Dale Oliver classic.
No.
We got to hear one later on, Christian Cage, though. That song goes heavy.
Hell yeah.
So this show starts off, we talked about it, the TNA Impact intro. AJ Styles jumping at the screen. This is the one that I kind of remember the most, I think.
Yeah, I think so, too.
Yeah, I mean, I obviously remember the Impact Wrestling blue flames.
The rain one? You got to remember the rain one.
Yeah, you know, I mean, but that was more like the cold open. You know,
sure. Okay.
This is more like because it goes from this AJ Styles jump that screen, and then the pyro goes off, and it's fucking nuts in the Impact Zone. The look at this point is beautiful. This set is incredible.
When I think of TNA, I think of this.
They could have kept this going. I feel like if they did this right fucking now, if you know someone used Soundstage 21,
this is just what AEW looks like.
Pretty much.
You're pretty much right. They got me like the sets backstage look great. Yeah, everything looks just fantastic. So we start off with Team 3D versus Buck Quartermain and Lex Lovett.
Yeah, I didn't know their names until you just said it.
Yeah, I wrote down, I said, we're halfway through the match. I don't know who the fuck these guys are. He said, I think Don West said, and Quartermain's down. I said, Quartermain, who the fuck is this? Who is this
the
guy?
Only one I see, I didn't even hear that. I heard Lex Lovett, and that's the only one I remember hearing.
Yeah, so Buck, Quartermain, and Lex Lovett. As you can see, Team 3D beats the shit out of these dudes.
They've just easily beat them and hit the 3D, and it's over.
Yeah, it's one of those 1 hour impacts. So this is before they got on Spike and the 2 hour joints, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So they obviously just had a lot of jobber stuff. And honestly, it made for a super like quick and easy to kind of watch show.
Yeah, it was very easy to consume the show. There was not like a bunch of bullshit. Nothing felt like it dragged. It's cool.
Yeah, Team 3D. People wanted to see Team 3D hit 3D, and they did. And then they said, all right, well, you can, you know, get ready for the pay-per-view we're going to be on where you can buy it and then watch us also try to hit 3D again. And like that worked for them.
It was great television. Yeah. Just made for like getting them like just the greatest hits and move on. That's pretty much all we wanted.
Yeah.
I think that's when wrestling's at its best is quick consumption. You don't have enough time to hate it, and it's enough to, you know, want you wanting more. And I think that's where wrestling shines the most.
And
honestly,
it really doesn't expose anybody in this context either. Cause it just like, all right, 3D doing what 3D does, and then moving on and makes them look really good.
Oh, I agree.
Cody, this is not an excuse for the short women's matches on AEW.
He said, well, good. Goddamn, we've been doing that the whole time.
He said, you love short matches, huh? I'm going to make them even shorter.
Oh, mine aren't. Mine aren't. So Bully Ray comes down. He says, come on, 2006. And I said, holy shit.
Yeah, this is their first show of the new year, I guess.
Years
right?
ago, dude. How is that even... Wow.
Yeah, that's pretty
I don't know.
Fucked.
Maybe I'm just getting older, but 2006 still seems like 5 years ago for me, and it's not.
I mean,
yeah, it does.
We've been getting older since we were born, technically.
That's fucked up, bro. Who did this? So Team 3D is facing AMW at the next pay-per-view. So they did like a scuff death sentence at the beginning of this match. They didn't come off the top or anything.
Is that what they were doing?
Yeah, that was what it was. He didn't go off the top, though. He just jumped
off. Okay, that makes a lot more sense, though.
And they didn't say this, and they didn't even say it was the death sentence, but it was the death sentence.
They knew, and I didn't either.
Yeah. Well, you set him up and did the leg drop, so I was like, oh,
yeah, okay, that makes sense. So, sure.
So I assume they're kind of pointing at AMW here. Like I said, halfway through this match, don't know who the fuck these guys are. All I know is that Sting's coming.
And everyone's going to give Sting a tribute. That's kind of gross.
Team 3D wins with a 3D. Devon's titties were out for this entire...
Whew.
Fucking segment. Dude was just a menace at this point. He was in the best shape of his life right here. He was jacked,
dude. Oh, he looked real good. He looked real good.
They also fuck. So they played the Morpho Flex Fat Burner move of the night.
Oh,
it's
no!
Team 3D with the 3D.
Not Morpho Flex. I just kicked my Stacker 2 habit.
So we have to have a fat burner, just any fat burner. To sponsor our show, right?
Why don't we buy into a fat burner and just brand it Deadlock?
The Deadlock Fat Burner, and we'll do the move of the week, too.
Yeah.
And it's whatever the first finish of the night is. It really doesn't matter. We're just going to go straight
into it. Well, that's WSX style, yeah.
Yeah, they did that here. They're like, 3D, that's it. That's the move of the night right there. Go ahead and get this over.
It doesn't get better than 3D, to be fair.
We looked it up. Tony, you looked it up a little bit, didn't you?
Yeah, Morphoplex, I think, is how you pronounce it. Morphoplex? I don't know.
Morphoplex, something like that.
That's my finisher in DPW, the Morphoplex.
Yeah, I was looking at it. I was trying to figure out exactly what it was, and all I saw were like pictures of Larry Zbysko on the beach, and he was trying to shill this thing, and he said, he went on Twitter, and he's like, I don't know why all these wrestlers are getting popped with steroids. They should just get the Morphoplex. And I'm like, what the hell is going on here? He had one person like the tweet. I don't know what this is. I think it was Larry Zbysko's like steroids, and then he tried to sell it to people. But if you go to morphoplex.com right now, you could buy the domain. So
you can buy the domain. So it doesn't exist anymore.
Well, it does on like third party websites and stuff. So you can still get it. But
wow, that sounds sketchy as hell. Exactly what TNA would be buying into in 2008.
You could buy the domain for $5,298.
Holy fuck. That's a bargain.
Wow, what a steal. We can move the night.
Or 24 payments. 24 payments of $221 if you want.
Oh, there we go. I love me.
I better
go
straight to Larry Zbysko, too.
Yeah.
Larry's basically gonna say, why are you doing steroids when you can do this fucking sketchy ass fat burner and probably just die? I don't know, man. You're right.
Good point.
Thanks, Larry. What is with wrestling companies? What is with wrestling companies peddling fat burners to the fans?
Because all their fans are fat.
Larry's
no idea what
Stop doing steroids
was, though.
Yeah.
Stop doing steroids. It's a fat burner. What the fuck do you think steroids do, Larry Zbysko? Come take this fat burner. Larry Zbysko, hey, stop taking steroids. Start taking Morphoflex. One like on the tweet. Oh, it's from Larry Zbysko.
You ever seen Larry Zbysko? He doesn't look like he does steroids. He's just the plug, bro. He just supplies them.
Larry Zbysko is a fucking maniac. I fuck with Larry Zbysko. He's crazy.
Yeah, he's cool.
So Team 3D hits the Morphoflex fat burner move of the night. That's what we call the 3D from now on, is the Morphoflex fat burner move of the night. They cut a promo afterwards. Bubba says, we've been the ECW tag champs. Pretty good pop. WCW tag champs. Pretty good pop. And he smirks and says, WWE tag champs.
Boo!
Boo! You fucking bitch. You fucking bitch. We hate that dead
fuck
shit.
You. Fuck you, Vince. Die, Vince.
And he says, I've been tag champs 18 times altogether. And Bubba says, I would give them all up, all 18 runs, just to hold them NWA tag team title just one time. It means so
much. Honestly, I thought that was a pretty cool line.
Dude, this promo was good. Bubba, yeah, Bubba was really sincere. He said, also, fuck the Road Warriors.
True.
Yeah. Like, yeah, he said,
the NWA tag
titles
are the most prestigious tag titles in all of wrestling, and he'd give up all 18 runs just for one NWA tag title run. That was fucking cool.
It was cool. Yeah, I mean, he had good conviction here, and I really believe he believed that. I think that a lot of guys at this point did. That was one of Christian Cage's biggest things at the time was, I want to be the NWA World's Champion. Sure. Then they switched over to the TNA, and I was like, what the fuck are we, what is this?
I'm leaving.
This sucks. I'm out of here. And Kurt Angle said, this is great. I'm just going to hold all the titles then. Fuck it. Everybody leaves.
Yeah, no one wants these titles. I'll just take them all.
So Team 3D is facing AMW at the next pay-per-view, which I forget. Is it Final Resolution is the next one?
Yeah, yes. Final Resolution it is.
It shows a Final Resolution screenshot of, this is where they showed the Jarrett. Monty, Christian
Scorpion.
Cage, and Scorpion screenshot. I was hoping the Scorpion screenshot would be just as moving as the rest of it, but it sadly wasn't.
No, it was just still. Yeah.
I guess they couldn't get a real score. They should have got a real Scorpion to come in there and just fucking.
They should have had Christian holding a Scorpion.
I think Christian would have done that.
In a little cage. Christian's cage has a little Scorpion.
Oh, that's Victoria's gimmick. Hold on now.
My bad. Sorry. That was a spider.
Sanjay Dutt puts over Sting in a video package. They do this through the rest of the night. They make sure all the X Division guys look like a bunch of jabronis. And it's
God,
only
they all
X Division
like fucking
guys.
Nerds. God damn. I hated this. This is my least favorite part of the show. Everyone being interviewed about Sting. Fucking Swag D had to talk
Swag
about Sting.
Swag D
give a
with
fuck.
The deadlock. He had the deadlock hat on.
Swag D with
yeah,
the deadlock
hat on. He did
have
the deadlock hat on. That was
tilted to the side, too. He's all swagged out.
In 2006, man, he was a big deadlock guy back then. Yeah.
He's always been ahead of the curve.
Sanjay Dutt puts him over. We get it a couple more times. They do this a lot. They did it a lot with the X Division, period. Anytime someone big came in, they get the X Division, and they get him on the screen, and they'd be like, oh, my God, I love these guys so much, man. I hope I get to wrestle them one day because I love them so much.
I grew up watching them, yeah.
They, like, instantly makes them look like just big jabronis. They do it on the DVDs,
too. Yeah, these X Division guys look like big-ass marks. Yeah, yeah, this is what I thought. I'm like, oh, you're a big-ass mark. I'm marking out for Sting. He's awesome. I love him. He's great. I love Sting.
I mean, 2006 was a good year for them still. You know, 2005 was probably their penultimate year
sure.
when it comes to booking and everybody being over. 2006 was still a good year for them, but after 2005, the X Division started getting to the point where we kind of knew the X. Well, I'll talk about it a little bit later when we get to the actual X Division match, but yeah, it started going downhill kind of quick. Not like the guys in the ring. Their M-ring was incredible, but
they didn't know how to. I mean, once Joe and Styles, and I guess Daniels to an extent, got as over to be like in the world title picture, they forgot how to book the X Division.
Yeah, they just never could find that next AJ or Joe or Daniels or anything. They tried I guess. So anyways, to go backstage, it's Jeff Jarrett and Team Canada. So this is a hell of a
Jarrett,
right
baby.
Here. Jarrett's backstage with him. He goes, what is TNA management doing? Rolling out the red carpet for Sting? Are you kidding me? Says Jeff Jarrett, head of TNA management.
Not giving Rikishi a raise, Jeff.
Free-woo. What is the fucking TNA management doing over here? It's not The Rock and it's not the dead
it's
man.
It's like Cody.
He's not dead. He's
talking
not the
about
Rock.
AEW management.
They're holding me back, man. Huh? we see AMW backstage. They're with Gail Kim. This is probably their number one. This is what I remember AMW for.
With Gail Kim. Yeah.
And the Jackie run was good, but Gail Kim ruled in that spot.
Planet Jarrett AMW was cool.
Scott D'Amore comes backstage and he says, Jarrett, that trollop Jackie, this is talking about Jackie Gata, by the way, not Jacqueline. Yes.
A Jezebel Jackie?
Yeah. What does that mean, that trollop? That must be a British word. You're Canadian. What's going on here? That trollop Jackie sent in a letter, and he goes, huh, what are you talking about here? I don't even know what the fuck you're talking about. It couldn't have been anything too crazy. He's like, well, I opened it. Well, that's illegal.
So, well, he's Canadian, so laws don't matter.
Oh, you're right. You're right. Yeah, there's a lot of...
So I just American looked up trollop. I looked up trollop, and it's a woman who engages in sexual intercourse for money.
Cool.
Oh, okay.
That's all right. Awesome.
Hey, Scott D'Amore. So Scott looks at Jerry, goes, yeah, you have maybe some Coors Light tossed back. You got maybe some loose lips. You say some stuff you shouldn't have said. And he goes, what are you talking about, Scott? I don't even drink. And the boys pop huge.
Everyone starts laughing.
That was the best.
That was fucking great.
Jarrett looks around
Flash
the room.
Flash forward to Mexico and throwing tacos.
Him throwing tacos and fighting with Vampiro.
He didn't even drink once at that point.
Not even
That's
once.
Even worse then. His excuse should be he's drunk all the time.
He said, what are you talking about, Scott? I don't even drink. And then Gail Kim gets pissed off because, Jarrett was talking to Jackie Gata when he probably shouldn't have been. And because, for whatever reason, in this point in wrestling, the only trait a woman could have in wrestling is she's a pissed off woman and she's looking to raise some hell.
Yeah,
that
was pretty much.
Yeah, stop being such a bitch and start coming out of the matches with me. All right, so we move into the next matchup here. Conan and Apollo versus The Naturals, which is Andy Douglas and
Homicide
Chase Stevens.
Homicide and Apollo.
Oh, you're right. The match
Conan was with them, though.
Conan was in the ring just as much as they were.
That's, I mean, the match
Conan
goes
didn't
on.
Even leave the fucking
true,
ring.
You're right. That's true. Yeah, it's Homicide and Apollo with Conan, and Conan introduces them as the Latin American Exchange. What happened here?
Yeah, this was the first time they ever introduced LAX. This was the first rendition of it.
How long did this version of LAX exist? Because I really, I remember Apollo. I don't remember Apollo being an LAX guy.
I don't either.
Yeah, I assume not too long. I mean, they didn't create really any moments here. I mean, this is just fresh off of, Conan wanted to make a new group, and that's what they did. So,
and the Naturals also in this matchup. I don't really understand why the Naturals didn't do more in TNA. I feel like they were good. I don't know if maybe they were just too much
tag
like
champs.
AMW. Yeah, but in terms of I don't know how to explain it. I feel like they could have been a bigger deal. I feel like they're not around for too long, right?
Okay, I figured this out. So Apollo no-showed Final Resolution, and he was removed from TNA television.
Oh, maybe he asked for a raise. Jared said, well, you ain't dead.
He said, I got two questions. Are you dead? Are you The Rock?
Get the fuck out of my office.
So he no-showed Final Resolution, and that was the LAX.
Oh, okay, and then Hernandez got a job. That's cool. Well, that's
it worked out, I guess.
Damn, it could have stayed a Homicide and Apollo forever. That's weird.
Yeah, that is weird to think about. I can't believe we randomly watched the episode where LAX formed.
Yeah, what the fuck? I was so confused. I was watching with Deb. I was like, oh, this must be before LAX. And then Conan says, this is LAX. I was like, oh, I'm an asshole. This is LAX.
Is it just me, or does Apollo look like Batista here? Or is he trying to look like Batista or something? Because I just saw Batista here the entire time.
I think it's a coincidence because I think he just happens to look like Batista in general.
Okay.
Yeah, so I think even before he was like LAX dude, I remember Apollo like early TNA had like the red trunks and all kind of jacked.
Okay. Yeah, he was a lot more jacked a few years ago.
He was, absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, the Fairground shows, I remember him looking like a monster.
Yeah.
He's kind of looked like
he was in like the world title contention too.
Yeah, they were pushing the hell out of him. Jarrett wanted to program with him every fucking week.
So. Yeah.
So Conan comes into the ring. They don't even really wrestle. I don't think Andy or Chase even took off their fucking jackets. They just kind of took some bumps real quick in the jackets. And Conan gets in the ring and whacks the referee in the face and then brings out the slapjack, the blackjack,
the madball, the madball.
Yeah, Tanae was calling it the blackjack. I thought it was the slapjack. And then Tony, I know, has said madball before. So what the fuck is this thing called?
You know, I think it changes. Whatever Conan says it is, I'm just going to believe Conan.
You know, he's a big WCW guy, so he was thinking Slapjack from WCW. They used to have a Slapjack in WCW. You remember that? Back in the
but
day?
He didn't want to call it that, so he called it Blackjack?
Oh, I do remember.
Did he call it Slapjack?
No, he called it Blackjack.
I thought it was Snack Pack. no, that's not right.
It was the Madball, though. It's the Madball. That's what
okay, well, yeah, he hits the ref with the crack
pack. He just punches the ref,
Pack.
Oh no! Right, yeah. He punches the ref and then he snack packs the
blackjack, the snack pack. Yeah, he got
ride back. Yeah, ride back.
Got the whack pack. The whack pack.
The whack pack.
Beetlejuice
from Howard Stern.
Beetlejuice here.
Why do you call you high pitch egg?
My voice sounds like this. Why do you call you the dwarf? Why are they calling you the dwarf?
Why are you the
drunken,
angry dwarf? It's because I'm drunk.
He's a dwarf standing there with
a beard in his hand and he's a dwarf. Why are you drunk and a dwarf?
Yeah, I don't know. It could be anything.
BG James comes out for the save and gets beat up. And then Kip James comes out with a tied up shirt and a chair and makes a save. And there you go. And I don't know if you noticed, but I'm pretty sure this first LAX theme is just a ripoff of the Filthy Animals theme from WCW.
Yeah, I think. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Probably. Yeah.
Yeah. So I was like, oh, that's weird.
Yeah. I mean, LAX got DQ'd. I mean, they didn't even, like I said, didn't even take the jackets off. It was pretty much over with. BG James tried to make a save. I love that BG James tried to make a save, got his ass kicked too. So, oh, shit.
Such is life.
You had to have 6'5". I mean, Kip James was in it. I mean, he kind of looks the same right now, to be honest.
He looks
with
like,
you.
Dude, TNA, Kip James, and current day Billy Gunn, exactly the same person.
Yeah.
He should wear the 9 Inch Nails tank top all scrunched out on TV right now. It'd make him and Austin Gunn a lot more cool. Imagine 9 Inch Nails tank top and a quick draw all in one segment.
Yeah, ooh. Billy Gunn should put the shirt on, and that's the end of the sentence.
Oh, okay. All right, no Austin Gunn.
Thank you.
So Chris Sabin says, I love Starrcade. I love Starrcade where Hulk Hogan and Sting, they had a match and Bret Hart was there and oh my God. Yeah.
Man, Chris Sabin said, I would love to have a 30-second squash on the show with Sting. I wish he would squash me.
I love when the Hogan blew that fucking angle for everybody and lost a bunch of money for everybody. Oh, man. Good stuff right here. Yeah,
fucking
me too,
dude.
Chris.
Fuck.
It's crazy how quickly Chris Sabin, like, he was the X Division guy and then he wasn't all of a sudden. I don't know what happened.
He legit just exists here, which is.
Yeah, he was Mr. Ultimate X forever.
Yeah, like a fucking Asylum Hail Saban Chris Sabin was the guy.
Yeah. And then they had him on TV just kind of pushing Sting. Stinger's coming. Cool. All right, dude.
Thank you, Chris.
Speaking of dudes just being dudes, we get to Larry Zbysko backstage. Jackie Gata comes out with her honkers and is just real fucking angry.
True. She's all fired up with her honk honks.
Yeah, and Larry Zbysko's like, look, man, you get your honkers out of here, all right? I got other shit to worry
about. Get out of here,
trollop. Speaking of trials, Generation Next comes up. Shelly, Aries, and Strong.
Hey, they're not called
Generation
that. You can't call
Next.
Them that.
Where
That's
they?
Not their name.
Oh, what are they here? Are they not Generation?
They're just three guys that they didn't want to put the names up
just
on one nameplate.
Disgruntled employees is what
they were
they
definitely
are.
Generation Next and ROH at this point, though, right?
They may have.
Why the fuck did they put them together if not? I can't imagine.
Aries and Roderick were still Generation Next and ROH. Alex Shelley had turned on them a long time before this, but. TNA at this point, when they were trying to find new people for the X Division, just said, "All right, ROH, who do you got? And we're gonna take everything you're doing."
Well, it worked out for them. They got a lot of guys, so
sure.
So they confront Larry Zbysko. They say, "What's the deal, man? Like this X Division shit's kind of whack, to be honest. I don't understand why like no one's getting any push. It's just Daniels and AJ.
Yeah.
And wow, it made me remember like immediately how many fucking times did they run this angle after like this point right here?
That was the only thing they had.
This was the only angle they ever had was, why is the X Division not getting pushed? It was
why does this division suck?
Yeah, every year after this.
And then Zbysko says, why are you not buying Morphoplex? Maybe you'd get a push if you bought my fat burners, you stupid sons
of
bitches.
That's true. Just go on the gas,
you're
going to
make it this
kid.
Business, yeah? Well, here's some Morphoplex.
And then he pulls out this thing and he says, you got two questions here. Are you dead? Are you dead?
Sorry, we're going to push you accordingly.
Kid. Can't give you a push, kid. Sorry.
Yeah, Larry just kind of buries him. He goes, yeah, well, you guys are kind of like fucking marks. Honestly, you kind of sound like my wife, and she's a fucking mark, too. That's all, to be honest with you.
I see a bunch of crybabies.
Yeah, this is fucked up. Yeah. I said, damn, Larry, you had to say that to him. I mean, they're pretty good performers. I mean, they were the best on the show at this point.
Hell
so,
yeah,
like,
their match rules later on in the show.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, they could push them.
Larry cuts one of those back in my day promos. That was pretty good. I like that.
That's my favorite kind of promos.
James, you could probably do it better than back in my day.
Back in my damn day, we had Black Jack Mulligan used to take me out back. He beat the shit out of me. You know what I told him? I said, thank you, sir. And I went back inside. I did my job.
I really miss when them fucking marks were behind the guardrail instead of over in front of
them. And the biggest marks in the business right now are the damn workers. The workers are the marks, and that's you. You're the mark. And my wife's a mark, too.
Jim Ross, why are you here?
I'm trying to get a raise.
He's in WWF. So Jerry Lynn comes up and he goes, ooh. And walks out.
Hey guys, no. You got a match.
Ooh. He does sound like a big fucking nerd.
I talked to Tony a little bit before we did this. What happened within 3 years where Jerry Lynn went from ripped killer to, hey guys, you got a match coming up?
Hey guys.
How quickly did he age? For?
I just want to let you know, you got a match against AJ Styles, Chris Sabin, and Christopher Daniels.
He said maybe you'd be on that pay-per-view wearing such marks. Jerry Lynn, man, it's crazy because, like I said, he fucking aged 100 years in like 3 years.
Why is he not wrestling?
Yeah, he aged 100 years in 3 years, took some time off, and he came back to wrestle again, and oh my god, he de-aged. What happened here?
Dude, the tights. It must be something in the tights.
Yeah, I it was crazy seeing him here, because at first I didn't even know it was Jerry Lynn. I'm like, holy shit, wait a minute, that's Jerry Lynn. Yeah,
like, yeah. Maybe as a body double, like Randy the Ram in the wrestling.
Any backstage there's, is not actually
there's
him.
There's work Jerry Lynn and then shoot Jerry Lynn.
Goddamn, the workers are all Mark's brother.
That's true.
Take a bump.
Die.
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 Trollop.
We have Roberto Roode, and he faces off against Ron the Truth Killings up next.
Truth is his name.
Yeah, just Truth. They call him Ron the Truth Killings, but yeah, his name tag just says Truth.
Weird.
He comes out dancing and
cool.
Hits a bridge jackknife pin and beats him in like 3 seconds.
He wins in 5 seconds. I was like, so wow, good. That kind of rules.
Yeah, he danced to the ring, beat him, and then danced out of the ring. And Robert Roode said, wait one damn
awesome,
minute.
Actually. I was like, this guy the belt.
He says, hey, Truth, there ain't no damn 4Live crew no more. He said, hey, you're a thug. Hey, thug, you thug. What are you trying to say?
He's low life thug.
Yeah, what are you trying to say here, Roode?
You gotta say it is what he was gonna do.
Yeah, he had to say, whoa, 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 whoa. So he comes to the match. Truth goes back in the match. He goes, don't you fucking do it. And he goes, all right, we're restarting the match. So Roode gets some heat.
During that whole promo, by the way, Truth is still dancing.
He never stops.
Yeah,
he dances the whole time.
He never stops. It's the whole fucking time.
I loved it.
So they restart the match. Roode gets some heat. And then R-Truth throws him up again.
Roode got the hockey stick, got rolled up, pinned again. Truth just dances right in the ring this time.
Still dancing, just hanging out. Scott DeMore, cool. He dances out of the ring, starts walking up the ramp again, still dancing. Scott DeMore goes, that was the cheapest cheese I ever seen in my fucking life. He said, why don't you come down here and try it again? And he goes,
I bet you can do it again.
He dances his way back to the ring, and then they have another match, the third match in a row.
They had a little bit of a match here.
Yeah, Roode gets a little heat on him, and then Truth starts coming back a little bit. Then Scott DeMore gets involved, and that gives Roode enough to hit the Northern Lariat.
I thought that was kind of cool. I obviously, it didn't stick because the
Lariat to the back?
Yeah, like the back of the head. I thought it was cool. I feel like there's not enough moves that are to the back of the head, because I feel like the back of the head, I mean, maybe that's why, because it's a fucking dangerous spot to hit somebody or fake hit somebody. But I feel like back of the head moves are pretty underrated. I feel like even like a big boot to the back of the head or anything like that. Cool.
Yeah, I mean, Truth's incredible at this point. I mean, he still, like we talked about before, he still hits the same shit now that he was doing here. But yeah, I mean, getting hit in the, there's no like, you have to like yell at him, I'm coming.
Because if you brace, it hurts, it fucks you up more, right?
Yeah, I mean, like, you don't give yourself that bump, you know?
Yeah, right.
So it's just, like, taking a face first in the ground kind of sucks.
Yeah.
So I understand. It makes sense.
But yeah.
But yeah, I mean, Bobby Roode wins, motherfucker. Bobby Roode's
best.
He
swung at Truth with the hockey stick. Truth ducked it. Got hit with the lariat. Bobby Roode wins, and that one counts.
That's the one that counted. Team Canada wins, baby. Once again, Team Canada for the win. Then we have AJ Styles. He goes, I guess the most memorable Sting moment for me was, I don't know, fucking working with him. You know, I worked in WCW. I was there with him. So,
I was there with
Aaron
Paris.
Yeah, I was there.
AJ Styles also had herpes here. The fuck?
Yeah, so I fucked Sting. And that's probably the most
memorable.
I just
got done kissing the Stinger, actually. I was kissing him.
Sting told me it was a cold sore. It's fine.
It's all good. The sticker's here, baby. Somehow AJ is the least dork out of all of these that say things. Actually, probably Christian Cage is probably the least dork. AJ's next underneath Christian Cage. Because Christian Cage just no-sold it. But AJ Styles almost no-sold it, but he kind of like gave in a little bit to it. He's like,
yeah,
I guess the most memorable moment or whatever is like Sting wrestling or something. And like, I like Sting.
When he went from old Sting to Crow Sting, I like that.
Yeah. So, okay. I mean, I'll take that.
Thank you, Alan.
So we get a Samoa Joe promo backstage. He's the X Division champion right now. I fucking love this X title. It is my favorite X title and always will be.
Yeah, it's so good.
It's fucking great. I also love this era of Samoa Joe. With peanut butter in his era is also a good one.
He was trying to look good, man. He was young, trying to, you know.
He looked great. I loved it.
That puka shell necklace. He was looking crazy.
Oh, the puka shell.
Those go hard, man. I'm going to buy those online. Black Friday.
Cyber Monday. Black Friday puka shell necklace.
It's Sunday, Tony.
Cyber Sunday.
Damn, you tell me I missed out on the Black Friday.
Sorry,
deal.
Tony. My bad, bro. Yeah. I'll get you it for Christmas.
Yeah, nice. Puka shells, baby. Those used to be like actually in too, huh?
Hell yeah.
Puka shells.
And the anal bead necklace that AJ Styles wore.
Yeah. Shells and anal beads. Hell yeah.
My favorite
highlights.
Combo.
So Samoa Joe has a promo with Shane Douglas. Shane Douglas is not up for Joe's shit today. Douglas asks him a question, and then Joe doesn't answer, and Shane just walks away and goes, "You think I need this shit in a new year? You think I have to deal with this shit?
I don't know. It made it seem like this was Joe's like first promo in the company. Because I know he didn't talk for a while. He just killed people. So it could have been his first promo.
Yeah, Joe said, "Daniels, I'm going to fuck your wife. Long dick style." You know what? That's fucking true. That's all I think about whenever I see a Joe promo is that for whatever reason, his
the long
cadence.
Dick style thing?
every Joe promo is, "I'm going to fuck
my
your wife.
My name is Joe.
I'm going to fuck your wife." It's every Joe promo. Tell me it's not. It's just fucking is.
I mean, I guess I could see that.
It's
Joe
the cadence
says,
of it.
There's a thin line between brave and stupid, and that line is crossed when you step in the ring with me. That's a bad ass fucking line. That rules.
He goes, "You got kids? You got kids, you got a wife." Oh, shit. Where is this going? Every
Thankfully,
time.
Joe did not fall for the Sting bullshit because Shane Douglas said, "Oh, well, I got you here. What do you think about Sting?" And Joe just gave him the shittiest look ever and walked away.
That's awesome.
I don't even fucking like wrestling. I'm just here to beat people up. I don't know what to tell
you. Get out of here. I'll kill Sting.
That's exactly how you should.
I'll fuck his wife. Long dick style.
You damn right. Samoa Joe versus Sting for his wife.
My name is Samoa Joe.
Oh, fuck your wife. All right, here we go, baby. That's all I need to hear in wrestling. I'm ready. I'm fucking fired up. I'm ready to go. So we have Generation. I wrote that down. They're
no,
not Generation
Austin
X.
Aries, Roderick Strong, and Alex Shelley, and they couldn't fit their names onto the nameplate, so they had to keep switching the names.
So this trio of guys that work together somewhere else face off against Christopher Daniels, Chris Sabin, and AJ Styles, which is, this match is like an all-star group of guys here.
It
honestly.
Is. And not only that, they casually mentioned during AJ's entrance that at the pay-per-view, AJ Styles is going to go against Hiroshi Tanahashi.
Yes, they did.
Final Resolution.
I was like, "Oh shit!"
In 2006.
Yeah,
I mean, dude, TNA was kind of ahead of things. I mean, honestly, TNA
Hell
was.
Yeah,
there were a lot of things they were doing right, but we didn't.
I wonder if that match had to have been good, right? I don't remember it.
It wasn't anything to write home about. A lot of those matches weren't anything crazy. They did a couple different matches with a new Liger came over, I think, and faced Joe, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, Liger. Yeah. That did happen.
Yeah. I mean, that wasn't a bad match. It's not, they weren't bad. It's just, Especially
I definitely remember the Liger Joe one. So I guess.
Well, I think it's mostly because Liger was wearing the black attire, and like that was a big deal.
That was pretty fucking cool.
Yeah. That was a really big deal at the time. So, but I mean, it created that deal that they held on to until, you know. They decided the British invasion was more important.
Not the Brubs.
The Brubs have ruined it again. God fucking damn it.
That really killed the whole deal. New Japan hated fucking this. Maybe that's why Magnus is so upset about Japan. The whole company of New Japan said, "God damn, no way.
What have you guys done?
We are ending this relationship now. You're going to put our fucking titles on these dudes? Get the fuck out of here."
I mean, how stupid do you have to be, first off? Like, that's got to be... All right. So there are some definite, like, just absolute, just dipshit moments in TNA history where you just have to wonder.
Sure.
You just have to wonder, what the fuck was going through your brain? Like, that moment, of course, where they ruined that. we learned recently that TNA wanted Okada to bleed even though he didn't want to bleed, and like
that's
a weird moment in time, and then they buried him for it pretty much. So that was true. Something else. New Japan did not like that they buried the shit out of him, apparently. From I always just assumed they were cool with it because on Excursion you just kind of take your hits and move on.
Sure.
But apparently they were not very happy. It worked out for him because he just took the Pope's shit, and at the end of the day it just worked out for him.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
I mean, it's what it is. But yeah, I mean, of course the Russo stuff where, you know, Spike was like, hey, just don't, you know, you guys are cool, we'll keep you on the network or whatever, we like TNA. Just don't hire this guy back. And then Dixie not only hired him back, then CC'd Spike
secretly.
And said, you dumb, yeah. Spike is a bunch of dumb, dumb idiot fucks. Oh my God, those marks.
Yeah.
So, like,
yeah. Yeah, that's pretty, they got a long list. We should go, maybe is there a list of like all the dumb shit TNA has done? I know there's a CZW one. We should do like an episode where we go over these lists of like follies of all these companies.
Yeah, I mean, I think there is one, but I think I remember reading through it one time. I mean, a lot of it was like petty. They didn't push this guy here. I mean,
yeah.
I want a list of like the actual dumb garbage, like
bad, you know, business decisions,
blowing the New
like.
Japan
yeah.
deal, and yeah, like actual stupid shit.
Yeah.
So AJ comes out to "Every Day in My Life." This song goes real fucking stupid. I like this song a lot. Actually.
I love this song, dude. Yeah.
The lyrics are just complete dog shit, but it's what makes it so
good.
Yeah,
I don't give a fuck. This is my favorite AJ theme, I think.
Yeah, it's definitely up there for me. We should do an episode on him because he has a lot of bangers.
Oh, well, you know, people can suggest it for the next theme thread on the Patreon.
Ooh, yeah.
I let the inside show through the outside. What the fuck?
I'm trying to do my best to pass the test.
And show respect
that's
to the other guy.
Show respect to the other guy.
God, those lyrics are terrible, but fuck. I love that song.
Yeah, kind of stupid, actually. It doesn't make any sense.
I don't care. It's incredible.
My head, this guy.
How iconic is that entrance? It's seriously one of the best ever. It's truly
fucking
is.
Tremendous.
AJ was
so
the coolest dude in the world in the mid-2000s. People would make him every year on every game. I mean,
I was just thinking that, yeah.
Oh, my God, yeah.
Every CAW was just AJ Styles.
Talking about stupid TNA things, the fact that they didn't just pay him and let him go is insane.
He didn't even want a raise. I mean, he didn't even, what the fuck?
He wanted the same amount of money.
Or Dad or The Rock.
Fuck, man. I guess they stuck to their guns. That's true. I mean,
yeah,
in case
Daddy
you don't get money,
Rock.
AJ Styles ain't getting no damn money. So I don't know what to tell you, AJ.
That was
hit the fucking bricks.
Like 10 years after.
they stayed on the path. I mean, you stay
damn,
on the beaten
that's
path.
Fuck.
And it's all right. You know what they say? Every day of my life.
So. You know what they say? You are, I am, I am.
Pass the test.
Hey, show respect to the other guy.
That song is so stupid. It's
Got
so
it.
Good though. It
it's
really
so
is
good.
So good.
It's so good. I just listen to it. Just hanging out, listen to it. It rules. Christopher Daniels, of course, still the Fallen Angel. This was a very iconic look to the mid. These guys were just really important to wrestling in the mid-2000s. I don't know if Daniels has ever said it, but I'm pretty sure the Fallen Angel gimmick was literally just a closet reference to the higher power thing that he just ran with. It never really turned into
I imagine, right?
Yeah, it never turned into like a real gimmick. They actually gimmicked the Fallen Angel more in the video game than he ever did in real life. But
sure,
I think it was
just
a tongue-in-cheek to him supposed to be the higher power, and then he fell from grace and became the Fallen Angel, and that, you know, they ran to be a team.
I did like it, though.
Cool.
I kind of like, I like that more than SCU Daniels.
Yeah.
I can't imagine anyone, is there anyone out there that likes SCU Daniels more than Fallen Angel? I can't imagine.
Because he'd
come out with the thing over his head and he'd stand on the ropes and he'd push his fingers forward. I'm like, oh my God, he's
the
coolest dude in the world.
The Taunt's classic.
So
hell yeah.
Yeah, that shit rules. And the Angel's Wings at the time was like really fucking dope too.
I love that move. Someone should just steal that. He doesn't need to do it anymore.
It's all right. Mandy Rose does it.
Does she? Oh yeah, she does.
Yeah,
she
does. Right. Yeah, I think she calls it something with the wings too. Clip? No, that's somebody else. Somebody else calls it Wing Clipper or something.
Oh, that was fuck.
It's not the Wing Clipper's not the Angel's Wings, but it was
Wing Clipper's like the sit out gimmick though. Like the arm capture, like the double underhook sit out.
It's
gone.
It's straight down though, right? Angel Garza does it. I think so. Might be wrong, but I think that's what it is.
Damn, he couldn't just call it the Angel's Wings.
No.
I guess not.
Fuck off. So they start this match off here with not Generation Next and Daniel Sabin and Styles. They played a weird transition noise in the beginning, like something was supposed to be on the screen, but nothing ever showed
up.
Yeah. You heard that too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was weird. So the X Division at this point has got this huge fucking problem where everyone in the X Division is future big time players, but no one ever becomes a future big time player, and one is ever presented as a star. They're always just future big time players, which is a huge,
the next big thing.
It's a big curse, honestly. I would hate to be called a future big time player, like in
a division
like this. Fuck that. I'm a player now. Like I'm making
the
division.
I'm here now. Stop saying that I'm gonna be good in 5 years, Matt Cardona.
They said that about everybody, even like going forward to like Bischoff and Hogan era. Like Brian Kendrick's been champion for 6 months. He's a big future star. He's like 36.
He's been wrestling for 10
something.
Years
yeah.
at that point.
Yeah, like he ain't going to be anything else. You know, it is what it is. Alex Shelley just fucking Chris Bosch's Sabin. just
grabs him by the cock.
Yeah, just grabs his cock straight up and said, damn, that's a hell of a move right there.
That was kind of cool, though.
I mean, honestly, everyone here is really, really good at moves, but everyone here didn't do anything fucking crazy. They just did, everything they did was super impactful. Yeah. I mean, even
I
if it's just grabbing Saban's cock. Yeah.
That was pretty sweet.
It was impactful, you know, like, fuck, that would suck. Everything here was done with a reason, and that's why the X Division, as years went on, became just like, you know, moves. But early on, it's even still at this point, these guys were fighting with a meaning. And it was it was fun. It made the matches a lot more interesting. You know, bumping on this ring might suck, but goddamn, if everything doesn't look twice as fast as WWE at this point, 2006.
Oh yeah. The smaller ring helps too. Like this, you know,
The smaller ring and the way that like the ring doesn't, your foot is flat on the ring. It doesn't sink at all.
Right.
There's no sinkage here. Like it is. I don't even know what the padding is. I don't even know if there is padding.
You think there's some shrinkage?
Shrinkage. I don't know what the deal is, but I hope so, because fuck, it helped out.
Shrinkage. I think shrinkage helps with Alex Shelley grabbing Chris Sabin's dick.
Yeah, I mean, sure, he got his whole hand around it. I sure
did. He had a handful.
I sure. They did a couple of cool maneuvers here in this match. Alex Shelley did a catapult into Roderick Strong's sick kick that he just
ruled
the out of AJ. That ruled. Daniels did a sweet-ass reverse DDT Uranagi combo that he did on Strong and Aries.
Oh, that looks... I thought it was kind of like... Usually I'm used to them just doing like the Scorpion Death Drop version, but he like goes flat with it. I was like, whoa, that was kind of cool.
Oh, dude, it was actually pretty crazy that Strong was able to sit there while he was doing the Uranagi.
Yeah.
It's tough as fuck to sit in that position like that. And he was just like, yeah, I'm cool. You can do whatever you want.
I guess
that was good. Like I said, everyone here is just really good at this point. Literally everyone in this ring could have been world champion and it would have been okay. So a bunch of future stars, if I mushed. Alex Shelley ends up pinning Chris Sabin with slice bread number two. And, that'll show
you,
Larry.
Not only did he hit him with slice bread number two, but it was like, it wasn't in the corner. It was off like the middle of the ropes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess the ropes were super stiff.
Yeah.
Like Chris Sabin's cock.
No shrinkage here.
Yeah, so the story here was Larry, you suck.
So, yeah, fuck you, Zabisco.
I think they do something at the pay-per-view. I'm not too sure. Tony, do you have the final resolution card by any chance?
Yeah, actually, do I have it? Where is that? They do Alex Shelley, Austin Aries, Roderick Strong versus Sabin, Bentley, and Sanjay Dutt. Swaggy!
They just did a match, okay.
Well, there's probably more going on with Zabisco, and they just probably talk shit and stuff like that.
Oh, okay. So Apollo no shows. So Conan has to team with Homicide, huh?
Yeah, I guess so.
I see. Okay.
Was he in ring shape at this point?
I imagine Homicide probably did most shit there, but he probably could go a little bit. In 2006, that was only like, you know, a few years after WCW, right? Yeah.
Yeah. So after we get that, we get Christian Cage. He's talking about Sting coming to TNA. He said, yeah, Sting's coming. Another guy for me to beat.
What's his finish so I can kick out of it?
Christian was full dick out at this point, man. Like, this dude was full. Like, this is his push right here. This is Christian Cage at his peak in TNA.
Yeah, he ruled.
So, yeah, he was ready to beat the shit out of Sting. I don't care if you're coming to TNA. You do whatever you want. We're teaming here, but we won't team in a little bit. And then we get to the main event, which is Jeff Jarrett. Oh, yeah. and he's going to show his appreciation. Now, keep in mind, everyone throughout the night was talking about how great Sting was coming into the company. Oh, my God, I love Sting. I loved when he was in the WCW. Jeff Jarrett, on the other hand, does not fucking like Sting, even a little bit. Fuck Sting.
Oh, no.
This is how main eventer should present himself.
Earlier in the show, Jarrett said that he was, why wasn't Planet Jarrett getting a big TNA tribute? And he says, you know what, we're going to have our own tribute for Sting tonight, and this is what it is. Jarrett comes to the ring, says, I've been watching a bunch of half-wit amateurs try to do a tribute to Sting. He said, you fans may call him Little Stingers, who fucking calls him that?
Us fans
may call him Little Stingers. Us in the business call him Stinger Marks.
That really fucking pissed off Mike Tenay. He goes, whoa, I can't believe that.
Bitch, pussy.
You talking about the business? Yeah, I'm a little stinger, you know.
I don't know.
Little stingers out there.
I'm gonna give you Sting. So Jarrett says he's gonna bring out the early years of Sting, and here comes Eric Young dressed as Surfer Sting. It looked pretty good too,
dude. He actually looked like Surfer Sting. This is almost like Mr. Anderson level of Surfer Sting here.
Yeah, he's.
I was
blonde,
thinking that too. Yeah, he looked exactly
short
like
blonde
Anderson.
Hair, dude. Mr. Anderson looked exactly like. I feel like they may have all. I don't know if they put the figure out or if they were going to, but they definitely were going to put a figure out of Mr. Anderson and Sting, and I'm pretty sure it was just a Sting figure. I was convinced of it.
they looked a lot alike.
And Eric Young comes out doing the woo and doing the fucking flex, and it was pretty good, all on point. Mike Tenay angrily on commentary says, "That's Eric Young of Team Canada."
Mike says, "You damn right it is."
How's he know,
dude? The dynamic between DW and Mike Tenay was pretty damn good. They just seemed like they were best friends on commentary, just hanging out watching the fucking show.
So good, yeah.
I think. It's a shame that when you talk about the greatest commentary teams of all time, I don't think they get mentioned enough.
Like, no, they definitely should.
They definitely should. Oh, they're absolutely right up there. Like, you could argue, Lawler and JR is like, you know, it's hard to say that that's not like kind of the best combo. Even like Heyman and JR is one of my favorites, but like fucking Mike Tenay and Don West were so good. They love the product. They were like, even after they were gone, like there's, you can't replace them. They were the voices of TNA for me.
No, you can tell Don West just loved the X Division guys too. Like,
hell
he
dude,
everything.
He was so crazy about them. Yeah,
and Mike Tenay was probably fired up about not getting jabronied every time he called a move by fucking Bobby Heenan and Larry Zbyszko.
Oh yeah, true. That's true.
The professor, the professor.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, I mean Mike Tenay called all the moves, and Don West yelled, and it's like that's. There you go. I mean, what else could you ask for? Yeah.
That's awesome.
Undertaker even loved it.
Yeah, I know. I shot it.
Scooby-Doo. Go watch Hidden Gems on the Patreon.
Yeah, true.
Jarrett then says he's going to bring out, 10 years later after Surfer Sting, in 1996, your beloved Stinger took a turn for the worse. And let me show you what he was. And here comes again another great rendition of Sting. Chris Harris comes out dressed as Sting and all the face paint and the big trench coat and the trademark bat. He looked a lot fucking like Sting.
This is good, dude. They should be released like a 3-pack figures of this with the next
fake
the modern day Sting.
Oh,
in there,
I would
too.
Love the last version for sure to be a figure.
He came out with an actual crow.
A chicken came out with 1996 Sting, and Jeff Jarrett says it's a crow.
That's a crow, I saw it.
Somehow later on in this, Mike Tenay knows that it's James Storm. Fucking spoilers, bitch.
He's wearing cowboy boots.
I don't know. It could have been anybody.
Drinking beers with cowboy boots on, coming out with Chris
drunk.
Harris. Who is this?
Who is this man?
Oh my God, Eric Young.
Eric Young wouldn't stop flexing, which popped me pretty big. So we get to the next one, huh?
Oh, doesn't Jarrett say the crow aged, or somebody says the crow aged? I don't know. I just popped for that for some reason.
He did say, yeah, the crow aged.
Dude, everyone
different.
In the ring wouldn't stop moving around. Jarrett said, would you guys fucking calm down for 5 seconds? We have to get to this segment. We only have an hour.
Jarrett says, you guys don't know what Sting looks like in 2006, do you? He says he's a lot more tan. He's looking a lot different these days.
Oh, that was such a good line.
A lot more tan, huh?
Call back to his WCW run where he wasn't tan enough, brother, and that's why he dropped the title.
So here, as James said, the chicken is just running around the ring. At one point, Chris Harris has to point the bat at him to get him in the corner, to get him to stop fucking moving.
Yeah, who is this?
Monty Brown then comes out in Sting face paint with just in a golf outfit and pushing a baby carriage. And in the carriage is a little baby wearing a gigantic Sting mask.
That was incredible.
This is so good. Yeah.
Jeff Jarrett introduces him. He says this is current day Sting. He listens to Carrie Underwood or Martina or whatever other bubblegum pop there is. Everybody helps the baby get into the ring in the carriage. Monty says, all of this is for me? He's fired up. I love Monty Brown in general, but Monty Brown in Sting face paint is
this is all
that's the whole reason we watched the show. That's
yeah, the whole reason we watched the show this. Only because of the tribute gimmick, honestly, and Monty Brown in the face paint. Monty Brown starts talking. He looks down at the baby and he goes, he hits the Wild Thornberry spot on the baby. And he turns the carriage around. He looks at Jared and he says, ah, you know, this is how we stroll. I get him. Fucking get how we stroll. How we stroll.
Yeah, Christian Cage music hits immediately. He says, this is over. Don't ever fucking say that again.
And not only that, Tanay gets so fired up. He says, oh, you want to see how we roll? Not stroll.
Oh, he's so angry.
Gosh. Well, him and Tanay about to jump fucking Plant Jarrett. Fucking hate these dudes. Yeah.
Christian comes out on the stage and says, you're embarrassing yourselves and you look like a bunch of jack-offs. He said, that was bad news.
Christian, the guy who's wearing shit brown t-shirt. Looks
that's
like,
what I was going to say.
Look like jack-offs.
You look like shit. You're
dude,
right.
Christian Cage, you could... What the fuck? Every week with a new brown shirt. What was up with that? Right?
His debut. Like, that's right. So we watched his debut and it was a brown shirt too, wasn't it? What?
Only brown shirts, dude.
His whole team iconic duo. He wore these brown fucking shirts. They're so ugly.
His shitty boots, his jeans. He
fucking
bro?
Short sleeve shirt over a long sleeve shirt and a short sleeve shirt. He wore the brown shirts and the t-shirts like with his necklaces. What the fuck
I wonder
is
if
the
it's
deal?
Just a rib. He's like, watch this. I'll get this over this brown ugly shirt. I'm going out of it.
Maybe.
This ugly ass brown shirt.
He said that was the bad news. And Monty Brown says, this is entertainment. And Christian says, the good news is I just saved a bunch of money on my car insurance.
There was nothing. Fuck? That was the whole thing. That was
to crickets. To crickets.
That was his whole punchline was this Geico fucking line. What the hell?
In his brown shirt with a brown shirt. Yeah,
shitty
the brown
shirt.
Shirt. His bootcut jeans.
Christian says, you know what? Let me get the tables. And then the Dudleys come out with
it's
no
what the
tables.
What's going on over here, man?
There's no tables. They're Dudley boys. There's no tables here. The
table
Dudleys
this.
And Christian all rush the ring. No tables involved this whole segment.
I love that catchphrases just trigger entrances in wrestling. I actually, that's my favorite, one of my favorite wrestling tropes.
I do love that too.
Yeah. If you say anything like, oh you man, I can't wait to gore. And then
I feel like there's one that I remember the most. It was like a Shane promo. It was like, this was just before corporate ministry, and he's trying to find an opponent for he's trying to find a partner for Triple H to fight Austin and Rock later in the night. And Shane says, are there any takers? And the lights go out, Undertaker gets on the Tron.
And the lights go out and you look fly today.
I saw Timberlake. Oh, okay, yeah.
Same thing. Give or take.
That's true. Yeah, different era. Boom, boom.
Yeah, you know how it is.
So Dudleys and Christian rush the ring. They clean house. The chicken is running around. The crow, sorry. Running around in the ring as everyone's getting beat up. Tanay calls out that it's James Storm. Pretty disrespectful. I don't know how you knew that.
The chicken was running around. Yeah, crow was running around going, sorry about your damn luck. Sorry about your damn luck. Sorry about your damn luck. Cowboy boots and drinking beer. Who is this guy? Oh, my God, with the death sentence.
He actually said, I'm James Storm.
I'm James Storm.
I don't know who this guy. I don't know who this chicken is, but I'm James Storm.
Oh, I'm James Storm.
And the chicken comes from the back.
They shit can James Storm out of the ring, and then Abyss comes out, attacks them all from behind, and then Rhino comes out and attacks Abyss. Gore by Rhino. Baby carriage in the ring the whole time this is going on. I was really hoping they would attack Sting Baby, but they did not.
Gore the baby, yeah.
Gore the baby, yeah. Just all at the 3D to the baby.
Fuck, that would actually be crazy. That would actually be nuts. Get the death sentence.
Planet Jarrett and all their sting face paint on the ramp as the show goes off the air.
That's like the greatest. That's the greatest like shot right there. The camera,
the overhead shot. Was
that
my
was
favorite
the shot
one.
They wanted with like the people on the ramp, all of them dressed.
The
up.
Overhead
that's
shot
like
of all the stings.
That's the thumbnail on the video. That's why we clicked on that TNA video, because they use that as a thumbnail. They clickbaited us into watching.
That was a good way to get us in, honestly.
Yeah, we got to see the debut of LAX before they changed it again. And
Joe's possible first promo.
Oh, dude, when Abyss ran in the ring, the boot that he hit was fucking stiff as hell. He had some stiff-ass shots here. Yeah, and Rhino really gave it to him with the gore, too. They had some good stuff
here.
He
probably knew it was coming.
Yeah, I think
dude,
so.
Dude, I'm still pissed to this day that they put Monty Brown with Jarrett so that Jarrett didn't have to drop the title to him ever. Man, it fucking
that
sucks.
That sucks so bad, because I think you're right.
Yeah, he's like, hey, you could be in my group. How about that? But I really want that title. Yeah, but you could be in my group. Are you The Rock or are you dead?
You know what? We'll have a third section group. For Monty. Are you Monty? You're Monty. You're in.
I think you're in my group. I don't think you can actually win that title. That would, man, I swear he would have won the title if he wasn't in Planet Jarrett. Probably would have happened.
Yeah. I think so,
he
too.
He would have won a title eventually. It just sucks that his career just ended.